Today on our show, our very special guest, Father Clemens Galban, sits down with us to discuss Christianity in Europe, and Karlo Broussard explains whether or not there is a conflict between God and evolution. All this and more up ahead.
Father Clemens, you and I were talking about before the show, countries like Poland, for example, of course, which had its duel with communism, is one of the places where, so how do we explain a lack of faith in the Czech Republic and a vibrancy of faith in a country like Poland?
Well, it's difficult. There are a lot of factors that are involved in that, but I mean, one thing is clear is that the Polish church was always definitively the spokesperson for the people, the Polish people. And even in the face of an atheistic regime, the solidarity of the church with the common Polish worker, the common Polish man or woman, was absolute. And they were seen by the people as their actual representatives. And that the regime itself was, although governed by Poles, it was an alien regime. So you did not also, I mean, so the communist regime had to make deals with the Polish bishops. In the Czech Republic, it was much more brutal. It was one of the most brutal repressions of the faith in Eastern Europe, and they just simply went through it like a hot knife through butter.
Sure, sure. And now, of course, Poland, we look at very much as, you know, an example of vibrancy, the faith, as compared to the rest of Europe. They have something of a birth rate there, but to be a Christian in Poland now, or to be a Catholic in Poland, you're coming under a lot of cultural and political fire. Is that fair to say?
I think it's in Poland. I'd say that it's still, it depends what part of Poland, too. The north by Warsaw is more secular, certainly, but there's, the south is almost, it's just anyone, when you come from anywhere else in Europe and you go to southern Poland, Krakow, for instance, and the diocese in the south, you don't recognize life because the faith is so vigorously practiced. Churches are full all the time. Turn the lights on, they show up. I mean, it's dramatic. The participation of the faithful in southern Poland, and apparently that is not the way everywhere. And of course, there are forces at work which certainly want to knock the church off of its pedestal, shall we say.
So one of these forces, Father Hugh Barber, as you know, I like to listen to the BBC from time to time, and there are I've forgotten the name of them, but there is an overtly Christian political party in Poland right now, right?
Yeah.
I've forgotten what they're called.
There's one large one, and then there's a second smaller one. I can't remember the name.
Right, and both of these come under fire from the broader European media.
Oh yeah, the EU type media,
right.
Certainly.
Right.
They don't like any of this Catholic stuff. You know?
No, not in the least.
My
third son was in Krakow for a few days when he was studying in Rome last semester, John Paul, and he fell in love with the place. He says, "I want to move there." But I think it was probably the beer and the sausage. He said, "Sausage and beer is very inexpensive."
Yes, well,
in Krakow.
Yes.
Yeah. Let's see if we can get a question in here. Before the break, can we go to Tim in Denver, listening on 1060 AM? Tim, welcome to Catholic Answers Live.
Thank you. How are you guys doing today?
We're doing great. Glad to have you on the show.
Thanks.
Well, thanks for taking my question. My question is this: how would you compare the church in Europe today to the church in the United States?
Okay. Well, I think you've asked the question for the rest of the hour there.
Yes. Yeah.
Father Clemens?
Well, I think it's very difficult to compare the two, but you have a very vigorous church in the United States still. The church in the United States, of course, has a very different history. It's only a couple of hundred years old, shall we say. And it has found its place in American society. And we also see, as it found its place, that there is a cooling of zeal among its members very often. Europe, you have the church plays a different role in many ways. There is still active faith the way we would understand it. You know, people who really are gung-ho for the faith and want it. But in the broader sense of the society, it's as much a cohesive social force which is not particularly bonded to Jesus Christ and the belief in Jesus Christ. There's a belief in the importance of the church and its role in, say, Austrian society, but I'm glad the church is there as a Catholic in Austria, but I don't really want to go aside from Christmas and Easter and make sure my kid gets baptized and confirmed, hopefully. But, you know, if that doesn't work out, then that doesn't work out. They would still want, though, the church to have a role in some sense, because it's just part of the essential identity of the country.
So there's a kind of a cultural unity or glue, a cultural glue that the church right. influences or brings to bear on daily life in Europe that in one sense really doesn't exist. Like for example, the calendar in Europe will still have, you know, religious festivals on it.
So I'm looking forward to this because, as you may know, I don't know if you know this, evolution is somewhat controversial. Had you heard this?
I think I may have caught wind of that.
Okay, so on the for years and decades and everything, Christians put a little fish on the back of their car, and that little fish meant Jesus. Right. And then about two decades ago, I started noticing people with the little fish had feet coming out of it, or the little fish was eating the other fish and it had little feet coming out of it, all of which seemed very strongly to suggest this is a science-minded person who says, I believe science, not the gospel. I would say that's probably the basic meaning. Right. So does God damage? I mean, is God damaged, or is our should our faith in God be at all be shaken by evolution?
Well, the short answer would okay. be no.
Oh, that's the one I was looking for. I'm so glad.
Yeah, there are a variety. You know, in conversation, somebody might bring this up and say, well, I don't need God because I have evolution, or I believe in evolution, not this whole Christian God thing, right? Well, that's so vague, right? We have to respond with simply a question and ask, well, how is it that evolution somehow proves that God doesn't exist, or at least eliminates the need for God in explaining things? So in other words, why is it that you think you ought to believe evolution over and above God? What is it
right.
about evolution that you think excludes God to where you can't have both but must make a choice either or?
So you looked into it, and there are actual arguments.
Yes, there are.
So here's why evolution eliminates
God. Yeah, so once we ask that question, then there are a series of reasons that one could give why they think evolution and belief in God are incompatible. So, for example, a couple of reasons appeal to chance. So mm-hmm. somebody might say, well, the chance aspect of evolution, right? The genetic mutation is random and blind over centuries, right? And over, you know, many, many years, isn't it's random and blind, it's chaotic, right? So the chance or the randomness in the evolutionary process proves there's no intelligent designer.
Ah,
that's
right.
One reason. So because notice the underlying assumption here is that chance and design are mutually exclusive.
Right.
You see? And if there's no design, well, then no designer. And so evolution shows there's genetic mutation by chance and therefore no designer. Okay. So how do we respond to this? Well, here's the key. Chance and design are not mutually exclusive. See, we can challenge that underlying assumption and okay. show that chance and design are not mutually exclusive because chance, so it's argued, and I think very persuasively, presupposes or assumes mm-hmm. the reality of design, or we might say directed activity. You see, Sai, chance is not some existing thing that acts in such a way to bring about some effect, right? Chance occurs when there's a convergence of causes that results in some effect beyond what the causes directly intend. Okay, so it's okay. Not something existing out there, right? It's an effect that goes beyond what two causes are going to converge, lines of causality, right?
Right.
One thing acting and another thing acting, and they're going to intersect. And the effect of that intersection of these causes goes beyond the directed activity of these causes, mm-hmm. right? So it's chance,
right?
But nevertheless, that chance occurrence presupposes or assumes the causes acting in such a way that they're going to intersect. Let's flesh this out with a couple of stock examples. Okay.
Okay.
So let's say I go to the grocery store to get some milk for my kids for breakfast tomorrow.
Okay.
Tim Staples, colleague and friend here at Catholic Answers, he goes to the grocery store to get some bread for toast for his kids' breakfast tomorrow.
He needs a lot of bread and you need a lot of milk.
Amen. Okay. And we happen to meet at the grocery store, right?
Okay, yeah.
And of course, we start geeking out into mystic philosophy, right?
Yes, that would happen. I've seen that happen.
All right. Now, notice the meeting is a chance occurrence, but that chance occurrence assumes or presupposed my directed activity. I had a goal in mind, go to the store, get milk. Tim's directed activity, go to the store, get bread. And the intersection or the convergence of those activities, right, results in this chance occurrence because our meeting was beyond our intentions and the directed activities of myself and Tim, okay? Here's another stock example of a grave digger digging the hole in the ground for a grave, mm-hmm. for a grave, and he stumbles upon a treasure. Right?
Right.
Now, the grave, that's a chance occurrence. The grave digger did not intend to find the treasure, nor did, on this scenario, the person who stashed his loot, right?
Intend for it to be found.
To be found by the grave digger. So yeah. It's a chance occurrence. But you still have the directed activity of the grave digger and the directed activity of the person stashing the loot. Now, this same line of reasoning can be applied to evolution. Chance is no different when we're talking about evolution. The genetic mutations that give rise to new species via natural selection, right, may be random. But that random occurrence presupposes a host of ordered activity or design. So, for example, there's got to be living things that are acting.
Okay,
right?
So for any evolution to happen at all, you got to start with living things.
You got to start with something exists. Well, not yeah. necessarily living things. You can even have inanimate things that are acting and interacting with things in such a way.
Oh,
here,
I see.
Here okay. we're just, you know, we're talking about, like, for example, in biological evolution. You're going to yeah. have to have some existing living organism that's going to act in such a way to strive to survive.
Mm-hmm.
And produce offspring.
Right.
That's directed activity. We can call that design. Certain things have tendencies to change into one thing rather than another and evolve into one thing. So you might have a fish, right? The fish, hypothetically, may have had this tendency or this potency or potential to evolve into a bird over many, many years under certain circumstances, right?
Yes.
Under the right conditions, but not evolve into a flower. So that directed action, that tendency,
right.
that direction to evolve into one thing rather than some other thing, from a philosophical perspective, that's direction, that's design, because yeah. there's an order there toward a certain specific effect rather than some other effect.
Right, a fish can't just evolve into anything.
That's right.
It can't evolve into a rock, it can't evolve into a planet. It can only evolve into a certain number of things.
Correct. And
okay.
in that very order itself, from a philosophical perspective, we see as design, and which we would argue ultimately will require not only a intelligence, but the supreme intelligence, namely God.
Okay.
So another example is the genetic mutation itself always involves some existing thing that acts on another. So you may have effects brought about by radiation, right?
Mm-hmm.
The effect that radiation brings about is a specific ordered activity and design, bringing about a certain effect rather than some other effects, right? So, or just even the sun, right? The sun giving off heat rather than cold and chill.
Yeah.
Or even frozen water giving off cold and chill rather than heat.
Yeah.
Even those very activities of inanimate things,
right,
bringing about specific effects rather than other effects, we say is directed activity. The fancy word for that is teleology, right? Coming from the Greek telos, end or goal.
Right.
The study of ends or goals. Whether we're talking about inanimate things that act and interact with each other in certain ways, mm-hmm. or even animate things such as plants and animals, right? And of course, us as human beings, although we as human beings do so with intelligence, with knowledge, and we know what we're acting for in these ends, etc., right? So the bottom line is that when you analyze it, chance really is not something primary, but it's secondary. That is to say,
there's got to be already a whole bunch of stuff there for chance to even happen.
Amen.
I got you.
And
okay.
Everything that's there is not only existing, which yeah. we'll get to later, but actually acting in certain ways to produce certain effects rather than other effects.
Right.
And that's directed activity. That's design from the philosophical perspective, not just complexity, although that's an aspect of design.
Right.
But it doesn't necessarily have to be entirely complex, just the ordered activity of certain things to produce a certain effect rather than some other effect. The acorn producing an oak tree rather than a banana tree, right? All of these sorts of patterns,
yes.
orders, right?
Yeah.
Within the physical cosmos is presupposed by evolution. And so the chance occurrences is just all of these things interacting with each other and the convergence of these causes bringing about certain effects that, of course, do go beyond what the directed activities of these things are for, right?
Right.
Or ordered to. But nevertheless, you still have directed activity. So if chance presupposes design, you can't have chance
unless something's already designed.
Unless you have the design. You can't have chance unless you have the ordered patterns of things behaving in certain ways and acting in certain ways, right?
Yes.
For certain goals and ends, etc. Well, if that's the case, well, then surely chance can't be a reason to reject God, because those ordered activities that chance presupposes, well, that's the very starting point for reasoning to God's existence, such as in Aquinas' fifth way.
But yeah, I mean, if sexuality is a gift from God, and homosexuality is a sexuality, which, you know, we haven't decided yet, but if it is, then how can that be directed, toward God in a proper way without just saying you ignore it or you treat it as a disorder?
Right. It's great question. Series of questions. First of all, sexuality in the Catechism there, 2332 and elsewhere, refers to that fundamental truth that I expressed before and you mentioned at the outset: male and female, he created them. So we are male or female. That's how God created us. So our sexuality is rooted in biology and God's will creating us as such. And so it's out of that sexuality, male or female, that everything flows. And yes, it affects all aspects of the human person. Now, in answer to the second question, when you say, is homosexuality a sexuality? It is not. In the context of the Catechism, paragraph 2332, it is an objective disorder. And I want to pause for a moment to mention that there are all sorts of disorders, disordered affections we all have. Some are more pronounced in different people. You know, I, as a man who is married, I wish I could tell you that all of my impulses were only and always toward my wife. But no, being in a fallen state, we will have impulses, thoughts, because of our various disorders, toward things and people that are not good for us. And so what we do, and I'm going to back up here a little bit for you, Luca, being a graduate student. And I believe one of the real root problems started, and we've talked about this, Cy, last week, believe it or not, back in the 1860s, and it would not actually be written on paper until roughly the 1890s, the whole idea of heterosexual and homosexual is a fallacy in this sense. It was created by a psychologist in the late 1800s, as a way of sort of trying to grapple with the idea of sexuality absent natural law theory, which of course has been the foundation of Western civilization. The idea that male and female, he created them, is not something found in the Bible. This is something we can know just through the pure and natural light of reason, examining human nature in relationship to God, who can also be known through the pure and natural light of reason. What happened, however, instead of understanding sexuality in the context of male and female, I am a male, Luca, and so as a male, I must act in accordance with my nature as a male, and a female the same way, so that if I have impulses, whatever they are, you know, if somebody has an impulse toward any sort of deviant behavior, from attraction to children, same sex, a woman that's not his spouse, whatever the disorder is, we begin with, I am a man and I am called to act like a man. So I don't, your last statement there, ignore, if someone has same-sex attraction, you don't ignore it. You're called to grapple with it, overcome it, and live a chaste life, because it's an it's simply an unacceptable expression of love, because it's actually not love, it's a disordered desire. See, what happened in the late 1800s, though, was when a psychologist, you know, because we had done away with the idea of natural law, how do we root any sort of morals when it comes to these tendencies? He came up with the term heterosexual and put a label on that. That's the good impulse. Homosexual was, you know, the impulse toward same sex, and that's the bad impulse. But the problem was that once you reduce our sexual inclinations to such a degree that an impulse defines it, well, then you've lost everything morally, because we have all sorts of impulses, and not one is any better than another. So if someone could argue, I have an impulse toward a child, why is that any worse than this? Or let's say a 42-year-old father has an impulse toward his 21-year-old daughter, or a 14-year-old with a 35-year-old has an impulse for a 16-year-old. You name the impulse. Once we reduce the moral law and morality to the level of impulses, we've lost morality, because then there's no way of grounding right and wrong. And that's where we're at now, I believe, Luca. We've reached sort of, we're approaching, I think, the end of the line. We've been reduced to absurdity here, because today, any impulse, if someone says, you know what, I feel like I should be a woman, or I am a woman, we've been reduced to such a level now that we'll actually mutilate their bodies because of an impulse that they have. We have to respect their impulse. We have to accept, if they believe they're a woman, okay, well then, by golly, they're a woman, in spite of what nature says, in spite of what biology says, and ultimately the God of nature says. So that sexuality must be rooted in, and that's why I said that before, Luca, in male and female, he created them. Once you understand that, you're rooted and grounded in reality. And so that when these impulses come, which we all have, Luca, all of us have disordered passions, impulses. If I acted on all my impulses, I'd be in prison right now. They would have thrown away the key a long time ago. But we have to order our passions in accordance with right reason and act in accordance with our natures, rooted in male and female.
Okay. I've done time in prison, and I've been really struggling with, can everyone truly be saved even if they've done horrible things but, like, regret it? Like, what does the church, like, I keep reading over and over again the part where, like, some people's hearts are turned to stone and there's just no going back. I mean,
no. The reason that people's hearts are turned to stone is because they turn them to stone. God is always willing to forgive anybody who turns to him. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says there's no sin, no matter how bad, that the church can't forgive if the person repents. And so everybody can have confidence that if they repent of whatever they've done, God will forgive them. God's mercy is infinite in the sense that it's capable of covering every single sin. The only time people end up not being forgiven is if they don't repent and seek forgiveness. If they're just closed off in themselves, if they which is another way of saying if they have closed themselves off to God's love and forgiveness, then God's going to respect their choice. But God is always willing to take people back no matter what they've done. This is the point of the parable of the prodigal son, where you have a genuine son of the father who leaves the family, goes off and leads a life of gross sin, and then comes back to the father and is welcomed back. And God's willing to do that for all of us, no matter what we've done, as long as we repent. And when you read about people's hearts being hardened, it's because they hardened them, and God is simply respecting their choice to be hard.
Mark, does that help you?
Yes, it does. Thank you so much.
Okay. Sure thing. God bless you, Mark. Thank you very much for the call.
Thanks for watching Catholic Answers. Join us on our live radio broadcast every weekday from 3 to 5 Pacific and 6 to 8 Eastern on EWTN Radio or the EWTN app. Find more videos and live streams on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/CatholicCom, or find us on Facebook simply by searching Catholic Answers. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations, and we'll see you next week on Catholic Answers.